Tantor Audio, a division of Recorded Books, presents Everybody's Classroom, Differentiating for the Shared and Unique Needs of Diverse Students, by Carol Ann Tomlinson. Foreword by James H. Borland. Narrated by Petrea Burchard. Publisher's Note: This audiobook includes bonus material. Please visit tantor.com and type Everybody's Classroom into the search box. Follow the link to the book's page. Then, under the Supplemental Content section, please enter the access code GROW, and then click the Unlock button to access the bonus material. The code should be entered in all lowercase letters. All figures and tables referenced in this audiobook can be found in the bonus material. Foreword. Mention the word differentiation to any educator, and inevitably, Carol Ann Tomlinson's name will come up. More than any other individual, Professor Tomlinson has made it her life's work to convince teachers and administrators that instructional differentiation is not just a desideratum, but a necessity, if schools are to truly meet the educational needs of their students, especially in our increasingly diverse classrooms. The rationale for differentiation is so convincing, thanks in no small part to Professor Tomlinson's tireless and persuasive advocacy, that few in the educational community would advocate teaching to the middle, or pretending that a class is made up of students whose readiness, aptitudes, and needs are the same in every subject at every time, thereby justifying a reliance on whole class teaching as one's primary instructional strategy. However, I visit a number of schools and sit in their classrooms, and you could be forgiven for concluding that differentiation has made relatively fewer inroads into educational practice in this country than one might expect, given its necessity. I have visited quite a few school districts where differentiation is the policy, but I have seen very few where it is consistent, quality instructional practice. A policy statement from the superintendent's office or lofty pronouncements from the ivory tower do little to help teachers develop the attitudes and skills needed to make differentiation a reality, not just an empty promise in American education. The reason for this, I believe, is that creating a differentiated classroom is no easy undertaking. It takes time, counted in years, not days, to develop the strategies and skills necessary for teaching in a truly differentiated manner. It takes substantial and continuing support from administrators and an appreciable expenditure of time and resources to allow teachers to develop into the kind of educators who not only talk the talk, but also walk the walk when it comes to differentiation. To address these challenges, Tomlinson offers truly helpful ideas and approaches that will allow one to experience the kind of success that is both immediately rewarding and also highly motivating to continue to do the needed work as they see students flourish. Almost 60 years ago, President John F. Kennedy, speaking at Rice University, told Americans that "we choose to go to the moon in this decade and do the other things, not because they are easy, but because they are hard." Sometimes, as is the case with making our nation's classrooms truly differentiated, we need to seek out the path of most resistance. And there is no one better than Professor Tomlinson to enable us to understand what that path is, how to find an entry point, and how to navigate it. Professor Tomlinson's preface begins with the following credo: "This book is about everybody classrooms, classrooms planned with the belief that every student in the classroom has unique strengths that need to be developed, unique learning needs that vary across time and subjects, and unique patterns of social and affective development." A more succinct, on-target explication of differentiation would be difficult to craft. As Professor Tomlinson explains, "this book is an invitation to teach hopefully, inclusively, and responsively in ways that stretch us as teachers and that stretch each of the learners in our care. Hopeful, inclusive, and responsive teaching. Educators who incorporate those qualities into their everyday practice can serve as examples of the heights those who are called to engage in our society's most important profession can reach and inspire their students to reach." Differentiation is difficult, but its importance cannot be gainsaid. I keep returning to the word hopefully in the passage just discussed. Hope is a quality that inoculates us against the cynicism that is an ever-present temptation in today's highly charged and sadly politicized schools. With hope, and with the sage guidance of Professor Tomlinson, we can envision schools in which every student has access to classrooms built around meaning-rich curriculum, engaging instruction, positive collaboration, and expectations that indicate a strong belief in each learner's capacity to do important work. I cannot think of a better description of educational excellence, and I cannot think of anyone more qualified to help us reach that level of excellence than Carol Ann Tomlinson. James H. Borland, Teachers College, Columbia University. Preface. This book is about everybody classrooms. Classrooms planned with the belief that every student in the classroom has unique strengths that need to be developed, unique learning needs that vary across time and subjects, and unique patterns of social and affective development. These are classrooms whose teachers work with the conviction that every student in their classroom regularly needs the teacher's attention, that no student is an inconvenience, and that no students should feel invisible or inconvenient in classrooms where they spend the preponderance of their waking hours. Those ideas are central to inclusion and differentiation, of course. Everybody classrooms add additional elements. That every student should have access to classrooms built around meaning-rich curriculum, engaging instruction, positive collaboration, and expectations that indicate a strong belief in each learner's capacity to do important work. These classrooms are invested in equity of opportunity for every student to participate in the best learning experiences a school can provide. That is not to suggest that inclusion means all students in the same classroom, no matter their needs. There are students whose struggles with learning and/or with life are so great that they require very sheltered support to make their way forward. There are students who are so academically advanced for their age group that public schools lack the human resources necessary to guide their growth. In addition, many teachers will not fare well if their introduction of everybody classrooms means their classes will include multiple students with distinct and acute learning needs, especially if those teachers have limited or no experience with differentiating in classrooms with students who bring a more restricted range of learning needs. The message in this book is twofold. First, we can and should do a much better job of opening our classroom doors to any students who can benefit from membership in classrooms where teachers understand, embrace, and address the human differences that every one of their students brings to school with them every day. Second, such classrooms and their inhabitants can only flourish if the teacher commits to offering each learner access to the highest quality learning opportunities our profession knows how to provide. Everybody classrooms are big tent classrooms with seats at the center of the action for every learner in them. They are all-embracing classrooms, welcoming what every student brings to the classroom every day, eager to work with the student as he or she now is, and excited to help the student discover what he or she can become. They are umbrella classrooms with a canopy generous enough to shelter students when storms come. They are all-encompassing classrooms where the learning environment, curriculum, assessment, instruction, and classroom routines are designed to help each learner take his or her next steps in growth every day. Everybody classrooms offer all comers equity of access to excellent learning opportunities and support for success with those opportunities. Everybody classrooms build teams of learners whose members come to understand that their similarities bind them together and their differences extend their reach. Everybody classrooms do not ask students or their teachers to be superhuman, but rather to work together, one step at a time, to become the best they can be on any given day and over a year of shared opportunity. If you thought you were about to listen to a book on inclusion, I think you will find useful ideas and strategies here. If you thought you were about to listen to a book on differentiation, I hope your needs will be addressed. If you are looking for ways to better respond to the learning needs of students who have experienced trauma, poverty, bias, culture and language differences, or other factors that challenge learning, you will find a repertoire of approaches that draw on the work of experts in the field as well as my own work, and point listeners to additional sources as well. If you are looking for something challenging, I believe you have come to a source that will stretch you as a teacher and as a human being. Lightly paraphrasing an assertion made by Barbara Borison, we need classrooms designed for the spectacular variety of young learners who populate those classrooms. Among them are students of diverse races, ethnicities, religions, cultures, nationalities, and orientations. There are students just learning the language of the classroom, students of fluid or transitioning genders, students who need glasses or hearing aids or who use wheelchairs, students who come from peaceful homes, students who come from chaotic or violent homes, students who go home not knowing whether there will be food available when they are hungry. There are students with widely differing academic proficiencies, kinds of social skills, sensory reactions, levels of emotional maturity, and behavioral patterns. There are students exuberant with the joy of learning, and students who have given up on school, or who are about to do so. There are students who have experienced trauma and are struggling not to give up on life. While these differences are not neutral, they are natural. They are part of the classroom, as they are part of all other aspects of life. We need classrooms that are prepared to welcome, embrace, and effectively teach all of these young people, each of them. We need everybody classrooms. We will begin the journey of thinking about everybody classrooms in part one of the book by considering what differentiation is, or what it should be, how it can help us build classrooms in which the one constant is student variance, and how a foundation of effective differentiation prepares us and our students for more inclusive teaching and learning. Part two takes a close look at 10 categories of learning needs, some of which are commonly addressed in inclusive classrooms, and some that reflect student needs less commonly addressed through what we tend to think of as inclusion. Nonetheless, those learning needs can result in major roadblocks for learners and significant challenges for teachers who teach and mentor those learners. In addition, Part 2 of the book provides general background on the 11 categories and delineates specific learning needs that are common, but not by any means universal, among students who are often assigned to a category, and makes the case that much of what students with these identified learning needs require for growth and success is common across the categories and is foundational to effective differentiation. In other words, it makes the case that differentiation, correctly understood and applied, results in classrooms that are ready to embrace students with these and other learning needs. The two final chapters in the book propose and illustrate the concept of teaching up to all learners in differentiated and inclusive classrooms, so that the kind of meaning-rich, complex learning opportunities often reserved for just a few students can be the experience of virtually all learners. One will also find, in the last chapters, opportunities to act as clinical observers in two classrooms and use a suggested framework to guide their thinking about the approaches of two teachers to creating everybody classrooms. This book is an invitation to teach hopefully, inclusively, and responsively, in ways that stretch us as teachers and that stretch each of the learners in our care. Listen along with me. Think along with me. Then look at your students and your roles as a teacher a bit differently. Carol Ann Tomlinson. Part 1. Exploring the Big Picture of Differentiation. Chapter 1. An Introduction to Differentiation. I like this class because there is something different going on in here every day. In my other classes, it's like peanut butter for lunch every single day. In this class, it's like my teacher runs a really good restaurant with a big menu and all. From an interview with a middle school girl. Big idea for Chapter 1. To become a master teacher is to become a master learner. As teachers, we would have to be beyond asleep at the wheel not to notice the remarkable diversity of students who enter our classrooms, or to remain unaware of the daunting range of strengths, needs, dreams, and fears those young learners bring with them every day. It is likely a little easier to overlook the reality that some of those students are lost to learning on most days because of life conditions and/or because the day's content is out of reach for them academically, socially, or emotionally. It is perhaps easier still to overlook the parallel reality that many of our excellent students are making good grades without stretching, growing, learning new things, or finding their ceilings of possibility. Perhaps easiest of all is overlooking how many students who appear to be doing fine, or at least fine enough, could be doing much better academically if our expectations and support for them were significantly higher, if we were helping them identify and refine their individual strengths, or if we made it impossible for them to feel invisible, even as we feel the pressure to cover what we feel must be covered before the test. The expectation that teachers must teach a prescribed and overpacked curriculum in the same way and in the same time span for all students in preparation for a standardized makes it feel impossible to attend to all the needs students bring to school with them daily. We find ourselves practicing triage teaching, sorting the young people we teach and turning our limited attention to those who appear most in need or at least most likely to benefit from the time we can spare them. Still, I believe most teachers genuinely understand that batch teaching fails a great many learners. I believe that many teachers seek ways to meet students at their varied entry points into learning, to move each of them ahead as far and efficiently as possible, and to help each of them discover and extend their particular strengths. Differentiation is an instructional framework designed to help teachers plan for those goals and translate the plans into classroom action. So what is differentiation, really? Differentiation, as I understand it, is an instructional model designed to make room for the needs of a broad range of learners to be meaningfully addressed in a heterogeneous setting. Differentiation shares the belief of inclusion that diversity in a classroom benefits all learners by, for example, providing all learners with a sense of belonging, reducing stereotypes, enhancing understanding, empathy, and respect among learners, modeling a world that makes room for all its citizens, preparing students for participation and leadership in that world, demonstrating the benefit of drawing on many experiences and perspectives, increasing friendships, supporting collaboration, providing flexible learning opportunities, helping students achieve to their fullest potential, and creating opportunity for each student to develop areas of strength and shore up areas of weakness. Understood accurately, differentiation is an instructional model that prepares the way for successful inclusion for every student in a class. Understanding and acting on the reality that human beings are individuals and therefore differ as learners in ways that can significantly shape the ways in which they learn. Seeing and planning for students as individuals, the student, rather than largely seeing them, speaking about them, and planning for them as a batch, the students. Looking for both similarities and differences in students' learning trajectories and planning around both the common and varied needs of students at a particular time in an instructional cycle. A collection of attitudes and skills that teachers learn over time by studying their students, trying different approaches to teaching them, and reflecting on what works, for whom, under what conditions, and why. And a way of thinking about and being in a classroom. Differentiation is not only for students with identified special needs, English learners, and students who are advanced. A different lesson plan for every student. More work for advanced learners or less work for students who struggle. Teaching down to some students and teaching up to others. Any specific set of instructional strategies. Or grouping students inside a classroom or in a school by what we perceive to be their ability. Figure 1.1 offers some definitions of differentiation that I have used over the years with my university students and teachers with whom I have worked during that time. Figure 1.2 provides some definitions from other professionals who think about and work with differentiation in varied ways. These figures can be viewed in the bonus material. Take a few minutes to see how they compare with your thinking, and to consider ways in which they are making similar points and extending other definitions. In chapters 3 and 4, we will look at a couple of additional ways to think about differentiation that are helpful in guiding teacher planning. Figure 1.1. Some basic definitions of differentiation. Differentiation looks eyeball to eyeball with the reality that kids differ and that the most effective teachers do whatever it takes to hook the whole range of kids on learning. It is a way of thinking about the classroom with the goals of honoring each student's learning needs and maximizing each student's learning capacity while developing a solid community of learners. Differentiation is shaking up the classroom, so there are more ways for students to take in new ideas, make sense of them, and express what they have learned. Differentiation is planning for the unpredictability of the classroom. Differentiation is respectful teaching. Differentiation is teachers seeking to see kids first and teaching based on what they learn. Differentiation is teaching to ensure the support necessary for equity of access to excellent learning opportunities for each student. Figure 1.2. Some additional definitions of differentiation. Differentiation is making sure that the right students get the right learning tasks at the right time. Once you have a sense of what each student holds as given or known and what he or she needs in order to learn, differentiation is no longer an option. It is an obvious response. Lorna Earle. Differentiated instruction is a way of taking into account the needs and wants of others without either relinquishing our own needs and wants or dominating and controlling the other person. In that way, differentiated instruction is more than just a method of teaching. It is a way of being human. John Straup, University of Virginia graduate student. I think of differentiation in terms of taking into account each individual's unique development, talents, strengths, and interests, becoming aware of each individual's distinct and unique characteristics, and then tailoring educational practice to account for these differences. Elliot Seif, author of Teaching for Lifelong Learning. Differentiation is teaching so that typical students, students with disabilities, students who are gifted, and students from a range of cultural, ethnic, and language groups can learn together well. Not just inclusion, but inclusive teaching. J. Michael Peterson and Michelle M. Hitty. Inclusive Teaching, Creating Effective Schools for All Learners. On some level, what we have come to call differentiation is just common sense. If there are genuinely important things for all students to learn, and if some students are not progressing, it follows that a teacher would figure out how to help the student learn in different ways, or with different supports, or over a longer period of time. Similarly, it seems logical that when students give evidence that they have already mastered particular knowledge or skill, their teacher would figure out how to extend their learning so they continue to develop academically and intellectually. And why would we not help all students discover and extend their unique strengths and interests, or encourage them to learn and express learning in ways that facilitate their success? Why should we not attend to a student's affective and social development just as we should to their academic or intellectual development? Common sense, however, can be uncommonly difficult to practice, especially in a room with too many young bodies and minds, and in the absence of mental images of how a class might look if students often followed different learning paths, rather than nearly always moving as a flock. In addition, few teachers feel solid in their understanding of how to make learning more successful for students who are new to the language of the classroom, students from a range of cultures, languages, and races, students who are homeless, students who have to bear the impact of societal inequities and injustice, students who experience an array of physical and/or cognitive barriers to learning, students who are advanced academically, learners who have experienced childhood trauma, those who march to a different and more creative drummer, those who grapple with sexual identity, those who bring with them two or more exceptionalities to the classroom, and so on. As an anxious teacher once exclaimed in a workshop I was leading, "How can anyone expect us to attend to students' needs when they all have needs?" Teachers aren't, and can't be, expert in all those areas. Still, the grand array of students comes into our classroom daily, and there are things we can do to make school much more hospitable and learning much more fruitful for each student. We just need the will to persist over time in developing the knowledge, understanding, and skill necessary to do those things. That is the ticket to success in almost any human endeavor. We ask our students to grapple with holding a pencil, learning math facts, creating the illusion of perspective on a flat piece of paper, strategically kicking a soccer ball, finding meaning in the unfolding of history, communicating in a language new to them. We don't ask them to master it all on day one. Rather, we do all we can to enlist each student's persistence toward a goal over time, lift them up when they stumble and get discouraged, and then gently insist that they once again focus on their own next step toward the goal and move forward. There's no magic in the process, just determination. The magic happens as the learning does. It's like that, too, in becoming the teacher who is a powerful, positive force in the development of each student, rather than generally teaching the class as though all students were a single entity. Caution, change ahead. Differentiation itself is not as difficult as you might think, especially if you give yourself permission to develop its skills over time. What is difficult is the reality that in order to develop those skills, you must give up some habits and practices that may have become givens in your classroom. You do not have to relinquish them all at once. It is a stepwise process. But differentiation, practiced in a way that enables you to put students at the center of your work, will lead you to make significant shifts in how you think about, plan for, and enact teaching and learning. For example, differentiation asks teachers to move from thinking about able versus non-able in favor of belief in their own capacity and the capacity of their students to learn. Coverage in favor of student understanding. A focus on teaching in favor of a focus on learning. The class as a whole to thinking about varied student needs. Fixed time in favor of fluid and flexible time, and assessment as judging, in favor of assessment as mentoring. The changes are not arbitrary. They are necessary for significant differentiation. They are necessary precisely because of what differentiation asks teachers to do. It is not possible to put students at the center of your work if you follow a strict pacing guide. It is not feasible to find time in your schedule to address the varied needs that exist in your classroom if you feel compelled to cover the curriculum by a prescribed date. It is not likely that students can grow in social and affective skills if you shy away from students working often in pairs or small groups. A good number of your students will be reluctant to invest heavily in learning if, for example, grades and/or discipline procedures feel punitive, or if the environment in the classroom or the absences of images of their lives in curriculum and instruction cause them to feel less than. The positive side of change, of course, is that while we humans often resist it mightily, it is necessary for our own growth and development. As you risk small changes that lead you to larger ones, you'll likely find that teaching is more rewarding to you, that your students are responding to you with a greater sense of trust, that you like having more time to connect with and actually teach individual students during a class period or day, and that you feel renewed in your work. Those are comments I hear often from teachers who have made the transition to differentiation. They also nearly always tell me that they can't imagine going back to the way they taught earlier in their careers. The journey to meaningful change is a long one. I've been at it for over 50 years as I write this sentence. As I look back over that time, I see myself becoming more effective and confident in working with my students throughout that span. I've always liked the answer noted cellist Pablo Casals gave when someone asked him at the age of 83 why he continued to practice several hours every day. "Because," he replied, "I think I am still learning." "Me too, and why not? I do not want to go to a doctor who does not feel compelled to improve markedly and continually in her practice. I would be leery of a parent who told me he learned all he needed to know about parenting in his first year or so as a father. The potential to remake, reinvent ourselves is a human gift. It extends us. I hope this book will be an invitation for one to opt for that path as well. A final thought. A key goal of this book is to help teachers grow a foundational understanding of differentiation, including the realization that part of constructing that foundation is a reasonable awareness of the kinds of needs students bring to the classroom with them, how they manifest those needs in the classroom, and some fundamental beliefs and practices that help a teacher respond meaningfully to those needs. Toward that end, the book has two parts. The first 5 chapters lay out the essentials of quality differentiation. Chapter 6 links those essentials of effective differentiation with foundational planning for effective inclusion. Part 1, then, proposes 12 key principles to guide a teacher's thinking about, planning for, implementing, and reflecting on his or her work in order to benefit each of those learners. These principles serve as a sort of GPS for teachers who want to address learner-specific needs and goals, as well as goals for the class. Part 2 of the book focuses on clusters or categories of learner needs that you will likely see in the classes you teach. What you glean from Part 1 should plug into Part 2, so you are prepared to use your expanding knowledge about addressing student variance to support more positive outcomes for a broader range of students, and therefore for you as well, step by step, over time. The contents of the chapters in Part 2 are largely a product of my learning in primary, middle school, high school, and university classrooms over 5 decades, how to be a more effective teacher for each of my students. Like most teachers, I began my career with little clarity about what it meant to teach well. In my early days of teaching, I felt like a failure more often than not. Through most of my 20 years in K-12 classrooms, I was privileged to work with a cadre of teachers who were eager, energetic, innovative, and not easily dissuaded. We met regularly. We shared classroom experiences. We confronted our inadequacies and tried to sort out our confusion. Sometimes we scrapped our ideas and started over. Sometimes we held on to the kernel of an idea and reshaped it. Sometimes we just tweaked. Occasionally, all we needed to do was polish. After nearly 20 years of that collegial process, we understood so many more things about teaching and learning than when we began our work together. We had both greater depth and breadth of knowledge. We were generally invigorated. And still we failed. But because we had grown markedly, we failed better, smarter, and with less discouragement. That's what teaching is about, learning. From time to time in the book, I'll share with you some of the experiences and insights my colleagues and I shared as we tried to become more effective in our work. These insights and experiences have served me and my students well over a long period of time. Combined with the opportunities I have had as a university professor in my second life as an educator to study our field's best understanding of the attributes of effective teaching and learning from both psychology and neuroscience, the depth and breadth of my knowledge are greater still. And I still fail. That's the nature of our profession. For me, it makes pursuing the art of teaching endlessly challenging and rewarding. I hope you feel that way as well. Chapter 2. Flexibility as the Underpinning of Differentiation. Elizabeth Ann fell back on the bench with her mouth open. She felt really dizzy. What crazy things the teacher said. She felt as though she were being pulled limb from limb. "What's the matter?" asked the teacher, seeing her bewildered face.
Why, said Elizabeth Ann, "I don't know what I am at all. If I'm second grade arithmetic and seventh grade reading and third grade spelling, what grade am I?"
The teacher laughed. "You aren't any grade at all, no matter where you are in school. You're just yourself, aren't you? What difference does it make what grade you're in? And what's the use of reading little baby things too easy for you just because you don't know your multiplication table?" Dorothy Canfield Fisher,
understood Betsy. Big idea for Chapter 2. A classroom cannot work well for any specific kind of learner until it is designed to work well for all kinds of learners. My first meaningful insight about what we now call differentiation came early in my teaching when a small, fragile-looking boy with large, pleading eyes whispered something to me in the hall during a class change in the third week of school. The hall of our middle school was predictably noisy. He spoke softly and with his hand over his mouth. I had never seen him, but I assumed he needed help in opening his locker, because that was an endemic problem for students who came to us as middle school ramped up again each year. After three tries, I understood what he was actually trying to tell me. The message was brief and terrifying for both of us. "I can't read," he said, looking at the floor. He was not 12 or 13, as I had assumed. In fact, he was 15, and entering my class of 12 and 13-year-olds for the first time that day. I instantly realized two things. First, I had no idea how to teach reading, no materials that would help me, and no sense of how to integrate him into the class in ways that would lead to respect and camaraderie among his peers. Second, and far more importantly, I knew I could not let him down. It was an act of great courage and trust that I had seen as first period shifted to second. I would figure out what to do. I had no choice. And day by day, I did just that. Imperfectly every day, but well enough some days so that he made progress, and so did I. His name was Golden, and I'll come back to his story shortly. The word flexibility is not exactly a synonym for differentiation, but it certainly reflects a pivotal characteristic of teachers who differentiate robustly and effectively, just as it reflects a defining characteristic of an effectively differentiated classroom. Flexibility is necessary in a classroom for the same reason that differentiation is necessary. Individuals vary in a myriad of ways that shape their learning. They do not learn in unison or as a pack. Learning is a highly individual proposition. We are led to believe that we teach a class, but that is not correct. We teach young brains that have much in common, but that are also wired in ways that result in significant differences. And so we need to teach individual brains. Combine that reality with the vast variety of students' cultures, languages, home experiences, talents, interests, fears, social development, emotional maturity, school experiences, and temperaments, and the idea that we serve students effectively when we favor one-size-fits-all teaching with tight-ship approaches to classroom management seems poorly suited to contemporary learners. So what does flexibility imply, and what does it not suggest? What flexibility in the classroom means, and what it doesn't mean. Let's start with what flexibility doesn't mean. It does not mean chaos. The idea of a disorderly, effective classroom is a fiction. Many of us lived with at least some chaos in our earliest years of teaching. It's not something most of us care to revisit. Chaos is disruptive to students, even traumatic for some. It serves both teachers and students quite poorly. In fact, researchers tell us that flexible, orderly classrooms are necessary for complex thinking and deep learning because neither of those things is particularly linear, and both are somewhat messy and unpredictable. Disarray impairs many of the important academic and social outcomes teachers want for their students. Flexibility supports them. Evidence of weak planning. In fact, flexibility requires clear, thoughtful planning so that the teacher is always aware of learning intentions, what matters most in curriculum, time constraints, and even philosophical underpinnings that serve as a compass in the classroom. It is precisely that level of care and planning that keeps flexibility from morphing into chaos, allowing learning to work for the class as a whole, as well as for the individuals who make up the whole. Young people of all ages can work well in flexible classrooms when we partner with them to establish and clarify routines and teach them systematically how to use the routines to benefit their learning and the learning of their classmates. A lowering of expectations. In an effectively differentiated classroom, the teacher teaches up. That is, he or she plans first for learning experiences that will challenge advanced learners and differentiates in order to enable all students to access those rich experiences. Flexibility enables more students to work at much higher levels of thought and productivity than is possible in more rigid contexts. Teachers who rightly understand differentiation never teach down. Rather, they teach students how to learn so they can achieve more at higher levels of complexity. Flexibility does mean a teacher who sees that rules and procedures should serve students rather than students being in service of the rules. That is, the teacher understands that predictability in classroom routines and practices provides a sense of security and safety for students and teacher alike, and simultaneously understands that because human beings vary within and among themselves, the predictability has to combine with a certain amount of malleability to facilitate rather than inhibit the development of some of those variable beings some of the time. A teacher making visible a growth mindset. That is, the teacher deeply believes that each student has a reservoir of untapped potential and can learn far more than we or they generally believe they can. Flexibility in instruction enables the teacher to demonstrate that belief to students and to work with students in stepwise sequences that prove to each student that with focused persistence and consistent support, they can see their success unfold. Teacher-student partnerships in learning. Flexibility allows time for a teacher to observe students at work, provide actionable feedback to guide a student's next steps, teach small groups of learners, seek and respond to student voice and input in all aspects of classroom life and work, and guide students in developing increased agency as learners. Those things are difficult to achieve broadly in more scripted, lockstep, and tightly controlled settings. A teacher mindfully using the features of classroom life in varied ways that respond to students' varied needs. As often as possible, the teacher's internal question is, in what way can I use this feature, for example, time, space, materials, schedule, to support student growth and success? The next section of this chapter provides examples of classroom features that teachers can use flexibly to benefit student development. What flexibility might look like in the classroom, and why? There are many features or attributes of classroom life and work that a teacher can use flexibly. The goal is not to use them all at once or to use them all flexibly all the time. Rather, the idea is for a teacher to plan and work with the awareness that adapting the right element at the right time can boost learning for a student or group of students. Figure 2.1 presents 10 features a teacher can use flexibly to benefit student learning. Figure 2.1 can also be viewed in the bonus material. Figure 2.1. Some classroom features that can be used flexibly to benefit student learning. Classroom feature, time. How it might be used flexibly. Some students may need more time to complete work because they work slowly, have learning challenges, or need to explore a topic in greater depth than others. Why it can support learning. Flexible use of time helps a student work at an appropriate level of challenge. The goal of student work should be showing understanding, not finishing a race. Some students need more time to learn, at least some of the time. Classroom feature, space. How it might be used flexibly. A room can have spaces that allow for different student configurations and working arrangements, or can be set up in different ways as needs arise. There can be space for both individual and group work, for conversation or quiet work. There should also be a space for the teacher to work with individuals and small groups. Why it can support learning. Different student work often calls for different uses of space. Centers, stations, conversation areas, and other arrangements allow attention to students' learning needs and preferences. In addition, it is beneficial to give students choices about working arrangements when feasible to support their comfort, voice, ownership, and productivity. Classroom feature, student groupings. how it might be used flexibly. Students can work in groups with peers who currently have similar readiness needs, students of varied entry points into a lesson or topic, similar or dissimilar interests, similar or dissimilar learning preferences, based on student or teacher choice, or randomly. Also, expert groups can enable students to focus efforts on topics or segments of topics that are interesting or relevant to them. Why it can support learning. It is important for students to work in a variety of contexts to hear different voices and perspectives, rather than being categorized as a particular kind of learner. Students bring different strengths to different tasks and benefit from both contributing their strengths and learning from the strengths of others. Flexible grouping promotes respect among students and casts members of the class as part of a learning team to which everyone contributes. Classroom feature, materials, how it might be used flexibly. Students can work with materials at varied reading levels, with or without manipulatives, with print or auditory text, with models or visuals, or with texts in English or another language based on interests, preferences, or needs. Why it can support learning. Different sources and types of input can boost student learning at varied points in their growth, and also depending on their interests and approaches to learning at a given time. Finding the right source for a student can support both motivation and achievement. Classroom feature, working modes, how it might be used flexibly. Students often appreciate having the option for working with a partner, a group, or alone on an assignment. Similarly, it often makes sense to give them choices about how to take in and process what they are learning. Why it can support learning. Choice of working modes provides an opportunity for student voice while honoring a student's learning preferences. In many instances, it makes little difference how a student works, and if the goal is accomplishing a task, choice can facilitate that goal. Classroom feature, student goals. How it might be used flexibly. While there are typically common learning goals for students in a class, individualized education plans can specify alternatives for some or all of the class goals. It can also be helpful for students to have their own personalized goals or to work with goals suggested by the teacher for individuals. Why it can support learning. Whole group goals often do not take into account students' talents, interests, need for advanced work, or need to fill important gaps in background knowledge, understanding, or skill. Student-specific goals can address strengths, needs, and/or interests, and can support growth from a student's current development as well as ownership of learning and motivation. Classroom feature, mode of expressing learning, how it might be used flexibly. A good assessment, formative or summative, maximizes the opportunity for a student to share all he or she knows about a topic. Often, limiting mode of expression limits that opportunity, and thus the effectiveness of the assessment for a student. Why it can support learning. Limiting mode of expressing learning can be particularly constricting for English language learners and students with some forms of learning disability. For some students, opening up mode of expression allows them to draw on and develop strengths or talents. Choice of mode of expressing learning also provides opportunity for student voice in and ownership of learning. Classroom feature, student independence, how it might be used flexibly. When assignments and products call for student independence, it is important for that work to be presented to a student slightly beyond his or her current level of independence and with support necessary to continue to develop as an independent learner. Students in almost any class vary widely in their degree of independence at a given time. Why it can support learning. If student work assumes more independence than a student has, the outcome is likely to be of poor quality as well as a source of frustration and discouragement. When supports help students move through the work with increased competence, not only does the quality of the work improve, but also the student is growing in independence or agency as a learner. Classroom feature, models of student work. How it might be used flexibly. Seeing models of previous student work can help current students envision what a quality finished product might look like more effectively than directions or even a rubric can. Why it can support learning. Providing a student with models of competent work at a level of sophistication slightly above their current performance level can offer both clarity and an appropriate level of challenge that inspire success. Classroom feature, reporting student progress. How it might be used flexibly. To support student motivation, engagement, and persistence, grades are best reported in three categories: performance, what the student currently knows, understands, and can do; process, the degree to which the student's patterns of work contribute to his or her academic growth; and progress, growth evidenced since a prior report card grade. Sometimes called 3P grading, this approach is both more revealing and more encouraging than most traditional grades. The three grades should not be averaged, but rather reported separately. Some reporting systems use 3P indicators. When that is not the case, a teacher can provide an addendum to the report card, communicate by email, or share the information in a parent or parent-student conference. Why it can support learning. Report card grades contribute to a cycle of discouragement for many students who struggle in school. For students whose grades are consistently high, report cards often do more to promote getting more high grades than to promote actual learning and intellectual stretching. A performance grade clarifies a student's current status with designated knowledge, understanding, and skill. A process grade helps the student and teacher develop a common vocabulary to advance student agency as a learner. A progress grade acknowledges growth, which should be a critical indicator of success for every student. Some illustrations of teacher flexibility in differentiated classrooms. Noah needs to move. At 13, Noah was not yet quite 5 feet tall and had the general build of a fourth grader. He was interested in all sorts of things, resulting at times in a fickle attention span. When he was engaged with what was happening in the classroom, however, he was in the game 100%. One day, a couple of months into the school year, the class was having a weighty discussion about a character in a story we were reading when I noticed that Noah was out of his seat and walking around his desk. I was a young teacher, relatively inexperienced, but I decided to watch him for a bit before I asked him to sit back down. He didn't seem to be distracting anyone. In fact, it appeared that no one even noticed him. So, for the moment, I decided not to intervene. The discussion continued without interruption, and several times Noah contributed to it, pausing beside his desk when he spoke. As the class ended, I was puzzled, but assumed Noah's wandering was a one-time event and thought little of it for the next couple of days until, once again, he began a slow trek around his desk. This time, I did not watch Noah. I watched the other students in the classroom. My concern was perhaps typical of a novice teacher. I was afraid that if I let Noah get up and wander, other students would want to do it too. Once again, if anyone noticed him, they did not seem to pay much attention. In time, I came to understand that he moved around his desk when he was thinking hard, when he was particularly absorbed by an idea. In a way, he was serving as a barometer for the degree to which a lesson or conversation was enlisting student attention. From time to time, Noah quietly set out on his slow, circular walks. As second semester began, Noah's father came to a parent-teacher conference evening. When he walked in the front door, I knew instantly who he was, because Noah's face reflected his so clearly. I also had an immediate insight into Noah's unusual need to walk. Noah's dad was about 6 feet 5 inches tall. Noah was just beginning a major growth spurt, and his body ached all the time. He was moving because it hurt not to move, and because he had been seated for most of 6 hours before he got to our classroom. Noah grew about 4 inches that semester. He told me later that during his seventh grade year, his legs and arms ached so much that he almost couldn't think. When he wanted to think deeply, he walked. That let his brain do its thing. Lesson learned. It's not necessary to be rigid because if I let one student do something, all the others will want to as well. They will not, and in fact, they are remarkably aware that different kids have different needs at different times. Can I turn in my project late? Students with whom I shared classes often created products or performances as culminating experiences for a unit, a marking period, or even a semester or year. They were opportunities to connect what we had been learning about with their interests, talents, or experiences. They provided us a chance to talk about and develop benchmarks for excellence. Students generally took pride in their work and looked forward to sharing what they created with a variety of audiences. There were opportunities for check-ins with and feedback from peers and me as students developed these long-term assignments. I sometimes felt conflicted as a due date neared. We had worked together to help each learner develop habits of mind and work that should not only enable students to create an end product they were proud of, but should also help them become more confident and skilled as learners. So when a due date was on the horizon and a student asked if he or she could have extra time to complete the work, I was torn. My knee-jerk instinct was to remind the student that following a timeline was an important skill for success, and besides, they should have had ample time and support to meet the deadline. A more reflective question to myself was whether the quality of a student's work might benefit from an extra day or two, and whether that quality might be more important than my line in the sand. Still, these were young adolescents who just might have wasted time along the way. I wasn't sure that I wanted to enable that behavior. My compromise was to talk with the students about the conflict I was experiencing. I asked them if any of them had ever squandered time on a piece of work and then panicked when they realized they had too much to accomplish to complete the work before a due date. Nearly all of them laughed. Several shared stories. I shared a couple of my own. I talked with them about the difference between a student who might want to polish or extend a piece of work that was essentially complete and met the indicators of quality we had established, versus a student who needed time to compensate for his or her deficits in planning. They understood and felt the first student should be granted additional time while the second one should not. As the conversation progressed, one student suggested that I might create a form on which a student could request an extension of time. The form would ask for two pieces of information. First, a student would provide a detailed reason for making the request, with evidence that the work was already of high quality based on our class rubric. Second, the student had to describe ways in which the time would be used to extend the depth, breadth, or presentation of the work. The student would complete the form and place it in a request for extension box that another student volunteered to make for us. I would read each submission, examine the evidence and plans, and either approve or deny the request, returning the form to its author. We used that process for years, with good results. In addition to enabling students to push for greater scope or quality in their work, it also enabled me to invite students with specific learning needs to use the form. I did that one-on-one, privately. Those students could submit the form to share plans for how additional time and support would help them with reading, researching, writing, organizing ideas, getting additional feedback, and so on. Students who struggled with writing met with me to talk about their request. I am not aware of students who misused the process. The flexibility resulted in better work, less anxiety, and a sense of greater safety in the class, even though the expectations were always high. Flexible space in an inflexible classroom. Mrs. Schlimm was a history teacher whom I often observed and from whom I learned much. She taught in an aging school building with square classrooms and individual student desks. Class sizes were large. There was nothing promising about the space. As the class period was ending on the first day I visited her class, she asked the students to arrange the room in a seminar format on their way out. Every student moved their desk and occasionally a desk that was unoccupied that day, to a new location. The transition happened so quickly and effortlessly that it seemed like magic to me. Students in the next class knew where to sit as they came into the room and understood generally the kind of work for which they needed to prepare. As that class ended, she asked the students to arrange the desks for learning stations. Once again, student movement was purposeful, quiet, and swift. As the day progressed, students moved the furniture two more times. Each time, I shook my head with some dismay as I asked myself why I had felt it necessary to move all the classroom furniture that needed moving for the past 15 years. Early in the year, Mrs. Schlimm previewed for her students several ideas she had for making the class lively and relevant for them. She asked for their responses to and suggestions for each of the ideas she presented and invited them to offer additional possibilities. As the discussion progressed, she asked the students what she and they would need to do to make the ideas possible in their classroom space. Students quickly realized that much of what they were envisioning could not work with rows of desks facing forward, so they would have to figure out different ways to arrange the desks and would all have to pitch in to move the desks as their work called for different arrangements. Mrs. Schlimm drew four seating charts in addition to the forward-facing desk configuration and gave each one a name. The name did not necessarily reflect the nature of work students would do in that arrangement. For example, students did have seminars in the seminar format, but other activities that worked well in that arrangement also occurred in that format. Over the first couple of weeks of school, she and the students rehearsed moving the furniture in a way that would be efficient without being disruptive. They looked forward to the variety of approaches to learning in that history class and happily contributed to those opportunities in a variety of ways. Lesson learned. If I mean for the classroom to be ours and not mine, I need to take care to enlist the students as my partners in as many aspects of our shared life as possible. Flexibility requires shared understanding and responsibility. Learning to choose partners wisely. Ms. Harold worked consistently with her first graders to help them make thoughtful choices, including in choosing working partners. One day, after she had explained an assignment to her students and had made certain they understood the work ahead, she asked them to tell her what skills and strengths the assignment required. They replied that it called for reading, understanding what they read, writing, and using their imaginations. "I agree," she said. "Now tap on the side of your head like we do when we are thinking hard and figure out which of those skills are strong ones for you." After sharing their conclusions with a classmate seated on the floor near them, Ms. Harold said, "Okay, now tap and think again, and this time, think about the skills you would like some help with as you work." Following another brief exchange with a different student, she continued, "Third time, tap again and think about a student you know who might make a good partner for you because the two of you are strong in different areas." Next, she watched as students walked around the area and approached a potential partner. In time, she gave them a signal to stop in place and asked the partners to talk about their strengths and their needs for support, to be sure they were prepared to help one another do the work really well so they could be proud of what they accomplished. A few students decided to change partners. One group ended up with three members, and Ms. Harold told them she thought that they could make that work just fine. As the students found spots at tables or on the floor to begin reviewing their task and planning their work, Ms. Harold walked around the room listening in on their conversations. She also noticed that Seth and Jason had chosen to work together. The two little boys were full of life, not the best at following directions, and neither was yet a confident reader or writer. Kneeling beside the pair, she asked them to remind her what skills the work called for and was pleased that they were accurate in their response. She followed up by asking them to consider their own strengths and needs, and, after a pause to allow a moment for thinking, she continued, "So now tell me, do you think the two of you are a match made in heaven?" Without a pause, Jason nodded energetically and spoke, "Oh yes, Ms. Harold. Seth has looks, and I've got imagination, and we're on the road to success." Lesson learned. When teachers prepare students to make good choices, many students do just that, much of the time. There are always likely to be a few students, however, who will need more support in choosing thoughtfully. It is counterproductive to scold students of any age for poor decisions. After all, we still make them too. Sometimes it's wiser to say, "You know, I think I'm going to ask you to try a different path today, and we'll see how that goes." Other times, it is wise to let those students continue in their chosen route if the stakes are not high. Sometimes they surprise us, and we see them in a different light. Sometimes the experience provides a case in point that can facilitate an instructive conversation between a teacher and the students involved before a next choice. Always, however, we should continue teaching students how to be more aware and mindful in decision-making. It is every bit as important as persistence in teaching reading, math, music, or the skills of soccer. Supporting student self-direction and agency may be the most important learning goal of all, especially for students who do not find the classroom and its demands an easy fit. Learning from Golden. I had learned a reasonable amount about the dividends of flexibility before Golden further changed my teaching and my life. I began class every day by taking a few minutes to talk about something my students cared about. I used small groups for a variety of purposes. With some regularity, I gave students choices about what to read and how to show what they were learning. I asked for student feedback and altered my plans based on their input. Still, I had a lot to learn. Golden taught me that I could use different reading materials for different learners and still have all of them explore and talk about the same big ideas or concepts. He taught me that sometimes we must take the side of a learner rather than giving our allegiance to what appears to be a sacred and inviolable grading system. Perhaps most importantly, he showed me the truth of the big idea stated at the beginning of this chapter. A classroom cannot work well for any specific kind of learner until it is designed to work well for all kinds of learners. While I knew early on that I had an impressive range of learners in my classroom, before Golden, I still planned a common lesson, common activities, and common homework for all students on most days, moving among students to provide extra support or to try to extend their thinking. My differentiation was reactive rather than proactive. While responding in the moment to the signals students send to indicate that something in a lesson isn't working for them can be quite useful, that approach is clearly not adequate to help an English language learner master academic vocabulary or to help a student with a significant learning disability plow through dense task directions. Reactive differentiation was clearly not enough to help Golden chart a more promising course as a reader, and so I learned to differentiate proactively as well. I realized after a few weeks of struggling to find time to work with Golden while I helped the other 35-plus students in my class that the way I was framing my teaching plans was anything but flexible. I planned as though I needed to create one plan for the regular kids and another one for Golden, who clearly was not a regular kid in terms of his current academic needs. There were so many regular kids that their work seemed always to fill all the time we had together. It was a struggle to find even a few minutes to spend alone with Golden. I identified my problem one day when I quickly gave Golden an assignment I had created for him as the regular kids were responding to a writing prompt. I had to explain the work to him, of course, because he could not read directions. Although I talked softly to him, another boy seated at his table overheard what I was saying and almost apologetically asked, "Could I please do what he's doing? I think that might help me." This student was well ahead of Golden as a reader, though he was not close to reading at a seventh grade level. I knew that, but I had not come to terms with the reality that much of what I asked him to do was so far out of his current league that it made little sense to him. At that moment, I understood that my greatest challenge in terms of flexibility was that many students needed me in quite different ways on any given day. As long as I could escape that reality, I could ask them all to do the same thing in the same way over the same time span with roughly the same support system and feel okay about it. In that moment, on that day, however, I began to grapple with the need to plan proactively with the varied needs of specific learners in mind. It was a game changer for me. We'll look in Chapter 4 at a metaphor that can be helpful in thinking about flexible instructional planning. I call the metaphor...
We hope you enjoyed this preview. To continue listening to this audiobook on Google Play Books, use the link in the video description.